Site. Many, many thanks. I'm very glad to have the chance to speak here. But first of all, let's come back to the subject we had yesterday. There we spoke about tornadoes and how they developed in Germany. And that's why I looked into this chart. 1500, 1600, there were just a few observations of tornadoes at the time. You see more, and suddenly we have a leap. Starting in 2000, the tornado observations actually show a peak. And then a correlation was made with the mobile phones, with smartphones. That's the red line. So in 1500, there were few smartphones only, so fewer observations. And suddenly, you see now smartphones, mobile phones with cameras. One reason might be if there are more tornadoes, then people tend to telephone more, or the otherwise the other way around. When we get more smartphones in a society, we will have more tornadoes. That might be the two conclusions out of this graph, just to give you an interpretation of this chart. But let's come to climate communication. And I do dislike this. I'm not happy with this expression, climate communication, car communication, or lemonade communication. Have you ever heard about this? No, no. So it's a very rare terminology, but we actually created this kind of expression. It's an artificial expression, and we even have, as an institution, we have this word, climate communication, but I try to console myself. It is educational work in the sphere of climate using various tools, and that's what we do. We have events, various target groups, interacting target groups, publications, and media work. All these and many more. I cannot access all that during my speech. It's just a rough outline. But I'm going to focus on media, just because we just have 30 minutes and a lot of topics will not be approached. First of all, let's speak about Paris. We will have to speak about Paris and about prejudice and preconceptions. And finally, about topics and timing, the language we use, and the word climate change, the expression climate change. And in the end, the subject 1961 to 1990, and the topic of escalation. You see, it's even we will escalate the 30 minutes. I hope 90 minutes on TV, that's very fine. For 30 minutes, I'm not sure whether I will stick to the time limit given to me. Let's come to Paris. Paris is a problem of communication. I'm going to explain to you. A positive effect was, after a lot of work, since 1990 there have been negotiations, 60% increase in emissions have been made since then. Now we have a treaty, we have and now the media tend to convey the knowledge, or now we have a solution, but of course it will not be the stop of the climate change, but that's a bit the general outline. Now we have reached an agreement, and so it's our task, how can we actually now convey and communicate the knowledge we have as to the problems still connected with the climate change. So we have a very positive general trend. You see the four times three format, you must use 16 by 9 or even in a very broad scale. So it's also part of communication to bring all them together in a smaller format. But you need a lot of people in the first line, because most of the people want to stand the first line. They actually had to extend and maybe just one line, just the first line in the end, and in the circle, because nobody wants to be outside the bulk. This is a kind of collision or meeting of two worlds, and I'm trying to show you that. On the one hand, we have Mr. Schmidt, Peter Smith, a classical journalist, very, very known, and very used to speak to the public. On the other hand, we have the scientists, and with a name as long as their scientific knowledge, Professor Dr. Hans Peter, for example. So the journalist now approaches the scientist. Would you answer my question? Maybe I'm not quite sure. Should I or should I not speak to the journalist? So there are a lot of preconceptions from the beginning. Journalists tend to say, I'm very common with the two sides. I know scientists have a complicated way of putting things. It's hard to get clear messages. And the scientist tends to say, the citations are always wrong, they do not cite me properly, and the really important subjects are not conveyed by the journalist. So this is the scientist side. And there is a lot has to do with credibility of the media. 100% credibility, 5% for the television, for private TV, 5% for private broadcasting, radio broadcasting, internet less, but for the public broadcasting even more, public TV more, and newspapers still have the printed newspapers still have the highest degree of credibility. They have more time. There's print behind. So this is the credibility scale. But how about trust in the other person, in the counterpart? Let's think. If you are in face of a fire fighter from a fire department, then you have 95% confidence. But it's not about. But it's different. Insurance agents just a bit. Journalists, professors have a higher credibility, and that is why journalists tend to ask professors, because they have higher confidence. On the other way around, better say nothing. I'm not quite sure whether I can trust the journalist. So you need to see both sides to understand the dilemma. And some of the media, for example, with the big pictures, just the edition number of copies, and the Facebook links. That means the likes, more or less, the visits. This is FAZ, South German newspaper. SZ has more success, developed even more success, and that's built. Yellow press, so to say. And now, let's have a look at the credibility. 71% out of 100 for the FAZ, for the SZ 68, and 66% for Die Welt. But 30% for Bild, but the success is much, much higher and more. And somebody working with Bild, more university professors read Bild than FAZ. But scientists say even more non-professors actually use. So the Bild actually is read by a lot of people needing education, and that is why it might be interesting to properly dose information in the successful Bild newspaper in order to get a big public. It's not about wealth of information, but small little topical items. So, because the readers of the other papers, of the high confidence papers, they actually know more, and that is why for Bild it would be more interesting. So success in the internet and Facebook likes. Spiegel, for example, quite successful and high renown, high reputation, high quality, actually provides a good response. Focus is not just as renowned, but quite successful, even more successful in terms of the likes than a Star, and more successful a Star, and also Bunte, as a glossy magazine. But the reputation is less, so success and reputation are inverse. For example, if there is you see a click, 10 silliest things happening in the world, and then people tend to click on this in order just to have pure entertainment. But that's why they are successful, because information normally is a tricky thing. So infotainment would be a good approach to actually meet the public we want to approach. And in the internet, readers actually tend to have a light click on lighter infotainment purposes instead of No. No. So, and it's very important to arouse the eagerness of the reader to actually click on the image, so to have a good first image to be clicked on. So, this is a big dilemma we have. Sometimes you have headlines like this. How was it possible that this monster, how could this monster hurricane happen? A headline like this. Several years ago, I was in the Bild team. In the morning, it's for a review. Then there is a big conference of all team members, of all journalists, and I'm from the outside, I'm just a reader. You have the chance to say what you did not like. So I was able to say what I disliked, what I did not like. And I had some things to say. So, and they actually listen to me, and they even copy my messages. I don't know whether they use it, but one big thing is all headlines you see in the Bild must be replaceable by, is that really true? That cannot be true. And if you can, so, yeah, because the headliner should find always a substitution for that's unlikely to happen. So that's why, how could this monster hurricane happen? It was a small-scale hurricane, an isolated hurricane, quite late in the year, and that is why not even an eye generated. It's a monster hurricane is completely false. So the meteorologists now think, how could this headline happen? Yeah. Yeah, the reason is because the headline can be replaced by that cannot be true. So, yeah, you could say a late hurricane crosses the Atlantic Ocean. Nobody would have read it so. It's just an overstatement. In 1979, also a 100-year recurrence event. During this year, I actually decided to become a meteorologist. And at the time, in January, in the news, they said it's an event that actually has a recurrence of 100 years only. Yeah, and it was very sad because there were 3 days free in school, and I said, oh, that would never happen for me again. So, what I didn't know at the time, that the century was just the end of one century, and 4 weeks later, the new century began, because weather actually is a recidivist, so it tends to repeat itself. So once you have a flood, then you should think, oh, there might be a second event several weeks later. So this is a highway, a motorway. Normally, you stop there in any case, but for this picture, it was snow as a reason. And the headline was, and suddenly we have 2 people in there. Today, there would be a public shitstorm, so to say, would even lose his or her job. So, at the time, communication was slower, and internet was needed before I was able to find this photograph. Yeah, there are 2 people in big snow. They actually laid over a second picture for rousing emotions. You see, that's rather boring. And not even tracks, not even foot tracks in the snow. So just placed in there. And again, the headline can be replaced by "that can't be true." So it's just for dramatizing things. That's a dilemma, of course, because you change information, you manipulate information. And for the scientists, it is very difficult to go this way, and we find it unreasonable, but for journalistic reasons, it's quite logical. So, topics and timing. Journalists decide upon the criteria, relevance, material, whether there are pictures, whether there are text, topicality, so up-to-dateness and context. They need a framework, or if they have a framework, they tend to prefer information fitting in, new knowledge, new findings, being the first to publish the message. And when the media instrument has more success than the competitors, you will find this in the internet.
Die Motivation für die Wissenschaft.
And for the scientists,
haben eher die Motivation, eine unbeantwortete Frage zu
beantworten. Their motivation is to provide an answer to a non-answered question.
Ich war letzte Woche bei Klaus Bachmann.
Last week I went to Klaus Bachmann in the August edition. There is a big article about weather forecast and validation of forecasts. I visited him in his office and I saw this pile of paper last week, photograph. And let's zoom to this article, what makes the sun shine, and he made a circle, milestone, there's something, so he actually saw this, the sun has relevance, it's an important topic, why does the sun shine, what makes the sun shine, it's actually a philosophical question, and a milestone. A scientific milestone was found. This is what journalists do. They filter the information by keywords. And in the Geo magazine, you will find, in August, you will find an article regarding the, and also for the German and Swiss and international public, in front of the computers, please do not tell people that what the topic will be in the article. So very important, milestone, groundbreaking, we need to rethink, a big impact on new findings. All these, if you use these words, these expressions, Do not use all of those expressions, and do not always use them, but if you want to arouse the interest of journalists, use one of the words, dose it finely. So, or let's, whenever you use this,
so,
yeah. And new findings, whether it's about,
okay.
And then it's also a question of timing, having a good context. One example, let's say you have made a study regarding neon tetra fish in Amazonas lose their color due to climate change. So this is a black-white picture of a neon tetra fish. So the problem, your problem now is you would like to publish this topic and your study, but let's say you have a snowstorm and every media, and then you will actually, you will have no chance to get into the team conference of the newspapers, but they speak about snowstorm. They would say it's the worst snowstorm since the discovery of America, or weather will still worsen, or if you differentiate, the risk of this weather event tends to decrease in the wake of the climate change. So all that depends on the context of the general framework, and then you must wait for the moment, keep, for example, drought in the Amazonas area. Just keep it in a pile, wait for the right moment, then approach the press release of a team, and then you will have more chances to rouse public interest. So and all these newspapers have a team. In the beginning, they have nothing. In the morning, they have a lot of piles of papers. But normally, in the morning, they have nothing for the evening. And then they prepare material, collect material. The first is to find the topics. Then you have conferences between the journalists.
Unterschiedlich terminiert, aber klassischer Zeitraum ist so halb zehn.
Between half past nine and noon. This is when the topics are selected. What are we going to discuss? Do we have the pictures? Do we have somebody for an interview? Let's say you have a study and have a third party able to add. So if you have two channels to approach the conference, then you increase your chances to get through. Then research is started, original voices, quotations are collected until the final stop of the preparation. On the other hand, for scientists, you have committees, you have working groups, you have student tutoring, research subjects, a presentation needs to be prepared, and then a bit of research should also be done. So this is scientific side, so this is a completely different workflow. But for every day, journalists have the same pressure. They start off with a white sheet of paper, and this is an absolute stress, and you would not like to change with them. Very important also is use of language, formulation. Journalists expect scientists to give a clear message, a brief message, a concise message, and emotional message. On the other hand, scientists would like to keep it relative, differentiated, complicated, rational. That's a clear dilemma and contradiction. But you must understand this, because also, why in the end the quotation will not be as you mentioned it? Question: is there an increasing trend for floods in Saxony? Maybe it will be worse, maybe it will not be as bad as today. The risk analysis is actually part of the final report. That what was said in one of the presentations. Oh, I heard that.
Yeah.
This is a wonderful statement, but for the journalist, it's nothing. The journalist wants to have a clear message.
Or
let's say there are the coolest, the deniers of the climate change. They say the warming is 1.5 degrees, that's it. This is scientific nonsense. There's no probability, no statistics behind. But this clear message meets the criteria of the journalists. And that is why they have more success than the scientist, because they actually say that, whether it's true or not, it's not a point. So we have kind of hobby meteorologists, dummy meteorologists. The more you get closer to them, the smaller they seem. Yeah? And they know exactly summer will be full of rain. Such things, so-called experts, we say this is absolute nonsense. But this clear message is sufficient to enter the newspapers. But you have to discuss that with the teams in the newspapers. They actually supply what journalists want. Climate change. That's an expression I do not like at all. The German word Klimawandel. You said, Mr. Krassel, it's such a positive word. I would put it otherwise. It's ambivalent, because there are changes that are positive, because a part of the population likes change when it's to the for the better. But there are also the conservative people which would like to maintain, to conserve, to preserve what is. So it's not about black and white, but the two are differentiated. You have a climate change for the better, then everything's fine. But when you want to maintain the poor weather, then it's as silly as the other approach. You see the valuation and the difference in valuation. Left hand side, days above 30 degrees Celsius in the city of Hamburg, and for 2050 it's almost double. By 2050, the days of heat in Hamburg will double. Yeah, then it's almost as hot as in Freiburg. Oh, I was already in Freiburg. It's quite warm there, yeah, fine. Finally, more frequent summer, and summer in Hamburg will be as nice as in Freiburg. But it's not what I wanted to say. That's completely. You cannot put it like this. Then you phone the journalist and say, you cannot say this like this. But he likes the headline. But the scientist says, please do not say this. More frequent summer. And as nice as in Freiburg. Now it's open. Now it's so. But the message is the same. It's just a question mark, which is a change. And that's what I experience from day to day. When I phone a colleague, and very often she says, Frank, 20 degrees today already, but I would like it warmer. So the female moderators actually would like a higher increase in temperatures. So, and the general public, they like it comfortable. Why not warmer than before? So, and there you have already a communication conflict, because we say it's not good, and then they say, oh, they want to steal the nice weather from us. So it's a very sensible, subtle subject. A big, huge communication problem just starting is the reference period 1961 to 1990. It's a recommendation. We should always have a reference period, and we use 1961 to 1990, so everybody knows exactly where to place it. So, but now you have differences. In the period 1981 to 2010 and 1991 to 2020, these periods will also be used. I saw already the first publications like this. I spoke to a Bild journalist who told me, Frank, tell me, I'm looking at the December temperatures, was a very normal December with regard to 1981. No, it was warmer. Let's look at 1961 to 1990 in terms of international calibration. Yeah, but it's long ago, but we cannot put it like this. Let's use 1981 to 2010. What do they do? Then the climate change is actually eliminated because everything is normal, and you even strengthen this effect for the period 1991 to 2020 because the media will question us when we say that it was a warm summer. How to cope with that? How to handle this? Shall we stick to 1961 to 1990 or say, okay, then let's make a cut, let's make a break, and for the next 30 years we must live with a lot of normal seasons and summers and so on? So this is a communicative problem for the future. And very often it's the value you attach to this. A river underwater, record rainfalls. That's not normal, isn't it? Is it? Yeah, it's completely normal. This is a kind of, I used the word, that's a souvenir or a recurrent flood, and it will be repeated every 2 years. I like this word very much. I will use this a reminding flood. I like this word. I like this expression, a reminding. I don't know whether there are copyrights attached to it, but I like this. It is very, very concise and actually tells the people. Yes, and it's very important to find these expressions, to use them for the public and say, oh, yeah, a reminding flood, it reminds me. Yeah. And for the people in the street, it's a kind of clinical condition. It's a combination between amnesia and deja vu. Oh, I forgot it already. Yes, it reminds me. I had already forgotten it. Yes. So that's really, it's a pity. And very often, the statistical result is, no, it's only the wettest Thursday afternoon in this October, but this is, of course, a statement the journalists will not choose for publication. So, but let's come to the final point, escalation, in order to come to the end of my presentation. Escalation can be a risk in communication, but it's also a chance to create a self-dynamic continuation of it. Topic. Once you have a topic, and one newspaper or medium is in front, so first of all, choose a first medium, prepare that properly. You may prepare for that. You can tell them tomorrow at 9 we provide our press release. At 9 they have already the input, and all the other journalists actually they try to get hold of that. For very good stories, that's the way. You actually set the starting point. If you have good contacts with journalists, overstatement can be contraproductive. But that's normal in communication. because messages actually wear off, information wears off. We expect a warming of the global air temperature between 1.5 and 6 Kelvin against the pre-industrial time. Oh yeah, we had it already, I remember this, try to cut it short. If the development continues as it is, the consequences will be dramatic, will be drastic. And you say, oh, this, we heard it three times or more. Can you put it more in a more precise way? And Mr. Schellhuber once said, the humanity is on the way to self-immolation, to burning itself. Yeah, oh yeah, that's fine, that I can use. You see, that's a communication, that's a tipping point of communication. You exaggerate in order to go to have success in the public, but this is a quite strong effect, and in the end there will be a kind of shitstorm against you, a conspiracy and so on. So be careful, but so overstatement is interesting, but be careful. I can show you how such a resistance can take place. In 2015, in December, more and more freaky weather by the year end. In the North Pole, there might be higher degrees warmer than or superstorm of historic extent, and values up to 50 degrees above the normal values in the North Pole, according to the NOAA, and it was written in the Washington Post, 920 millibars values never seen before up to the North Pole. And this was all written in the Washington Post by reference to a scientist of the NOAA. The result is a press release goes around the world. All newspapers copied us, all media copied us. And in the morning I read this and I thought I'd fall off. And this is what what Bild said, North Pole soon warmer than California. Yeah. Up to 50 degrees warmer than normal at the North Pole. That cannot be true, huh? You just replace every headline of Bild by that cannot be true. So I phoned the journalist who wrote that. I phoned with the correspondents in the USA. You cannot do that. Can't you ask your colleagues? And the chef journalist of the German press agency, so it's not anyone, so let's say confidence 80%, he told me, Mr. Böttcher, I just verified the facts. Actually, also in Spitzbergen, we have 10 degrees. Yeah, there's the North Pole, I said. Yeah, it's close to the North Pole if you see it like this. Yeah, that's exactly the North Pole. So that means he has no idea of meteorology, and to verify he actually used wrong data, false data. We actually had published a counter statement, and the colleagues of the German Weather Service actually supported us. We coordinated the effect from two channels. They got press releases. It's not a 50, but 30. Okay, so and Bild understood that. This is at 12, it's noon, and 50 minutes later, then just 30 degrees above normal. Still a headline, North Pole temperature 30 degrees above normal, that can't be true. So maybe you understand my message. I thank you for your attention.
Wonderful, Frank. Many thanks for this hand washing. And it was very entertaining, too.
So
maybe if there are questions, even if it's already late, but the message was very clear. So if there are no questions, Frank Böttcher will still be here for a while. Thank you very much.